Tanter Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents What We Become by Jacqueline Druga, narrated by Leslie Nicole Ivery. 1. New. Over the warm small serving of potatoes, I acquired my first true glimpse of what we had become. The bowl was buried in my hands, and for the first few spoonfuls I never raised my eyes, shoveling it into my mouth like some sort of convict in a prison, protecting my food. I clenched the spoon in my hand the same way I'd clench the handlebar of a bike. When I was younger, my father would have a fit if he saw me holding my spoon like that. "We aren't savages," he would say. No, we weren't. Little did any of us know, we were savages in the making. What choice did we have? In some way, in some part of us, no matter how hard we tried, we all had savage instincts. The way I consumed my meager meal at that moment was savage. It didn't matter what it looked like or tasted like, I was hungry. It was the first time since it had all started that I felt true hunger. I imagined it was nothing compared to what others had felt. The potatoes were smashed, I guess to make them go further. They were seasoned with something because they weren't bland. Everyone seemed to have potatoes. Everyone I'd come across had them as if they were some sort of golden ticket. In a sense, they were. They were a means of survival. The clack of my spoon against the ceramic dish made me pause, and I just stared down. My fingers poked through holes in the knit gloves. They were so cold, my fingertips looked white. I pulled my sweater from the sleeves of my coat to cover my hands, and that was when I peered up. They all stared at me, and for a brief moment I felt guilty for eating. Was I taking from them? I was the stranger and the entertainment. Something to look at, I suppose. It was mostly women and kids, a few men. We sat in a small room lit by candles. The building was big, but it was night, no sun. We all huddled together, and candlelight was a means to stay warm and alive. My mouth hovering over my next bite, I glanced at their faces. Aside from different genders and ages, they were all so much alike. Splotches of black dirt smeared across their foreheads, noses, and cheeks. Soot from the candle smoke and fires, from not bathing, from not caring. Blankets covered their shoulders, and their eyes glistened in the dancing light of the candle. It was quiet, except for a few sniffles, and the howling wind that seeped through the cracks in the walls and windows, making an eerie whistling sound. I was grateful for them, for the meal and shelter shared out of kindness, out of humanity. It wasn't lost, not yet, and would be eventually. To see those in the room, one would think they had lived scared, hungry, and freezing for months or even years. Sadly, it had only been weeks, and we were still in the beginning of it all. If this was what we had become, I shuddered to think where we'd end up. 2. Minimum. July 4th, 6 weeks earlier. I was sure the people at Maestro Ice thought my husband, Glenn, was nuts. Even I thought he had lost it when he told me that he and his two buddies had ordered 1,000 pounds of sculpting ice. Those giant ice blocks weighed 200 pounds each and set them back a lot of money. Glenn said, "It'll be worth it, trust me." I replied with my stock, We had been together so long that nothing much really shocked me, and in a way, I welcomed it when something did. He was predictable. I was predictable. The blocks of ice were a nice change of pace. I was convinced the three of them were going to attempt to sculpt. After all, they were the best carpenters I knew, and if they could shape wood, surely they could shape ice. But art wasn't why he'd ordered it. A keen foresight was the reason. Following what was considered the harshest, coldest winter in over 100 years, we faced a summer that rivaled the drought of 1988. Long streaks of hot weather with no rain and high humidity. It was so bad the whole house AC didn't even make that big of a dent. Unless, of course, you were outside, got good and hot, and went indoors, then you felt it. Briefly. Glenn had gone to his aunt's house and retrieved an old air conditioner from 30 years ago, cranked it with whatever they put in it to make the air cooler, and put it in our bedroom. We slept well and cold. We never lost our roots or forgot where we came from. Other than the house we'd bought, we lived within our means. I remembered all too well when we were young, married, and Aaron was a toddler. A pound of ground beef was 2 meals for us when mixed with ramen noodles and tomatoes. It wasn't bad. We traded our 2-bedroom apartment for a better one when Glenn started working for Markland Construction. His side jobs turned into his own business, and we celebrated Aaron's 10th birthday in our very first home, one we owned proudly and made into our dream house. We added a pool and a garage with an in-law apartment for his mom, which wasn't exactly my dream situation, and a sister for Aaron. Although, at 12, he was a little too old to appreciate Cleo when she was born. We finally stopped working on the house, feeling somewhat satisfied with it when Cleo was 3. I wanted badly to get rid of the pool and fill it in. It scared me having a pool with a baby. Glenn fenced it in with an alarm that rang every time the gate was open. Annoying, but it gave me peace of mind. That pool would have been a saving grace in the heat had it not been too warm to enjoy during the day. At night, it helped. The heat was unbearable. I didn't understand why Glenn wanted to have our 4th of July picnic outdoors. I argued to have it inside. He had a plan. After firing up the grill to heat, a grill we didn't need, I swore we could cook on the patio slate. He and his 2 buddies, Bruce and Jim, took off. I had no idea where they went. Bruce's and Jim's wives sat with me at the patio table under the umbrella that wasn't making a dent in the heat. The kids were inside. I could see them through the glass doors. I wanted to take my margarita inside as well, but I had to watch the grill. Glenn said they'd be right back. I swear I was the only one the heat got to. The pool looked so inviting, but I knew if I went in, it would be like taking a bath. Anna and Jill chatted away. I nodded, occasionally smiling, but couldn't stop thinking about how hot it was. I had one of those fans that blew water on me. I kept lifting it, spraying myself, and grunting in heated frustration. Mackenzie, Jill said my name with a chuckle. Don't think about the heat and it won't bother you. Don't think about it, I asked. Are you serious? It's 105. I can't have my phone out here. Well, it won't be for long, said Anna. We're on day 31, I said. You're counting? Anna asked, laughing. 3 more days. They have that cold front in Canada. We're supposed to get in a couple days.
Cold front, I shook my head. Yeah, it'll drop to 90.
Still cooler than it is now, Anna replied. I brought my margarita to my lips. The frozen beverage wasn't surviving. I'd down it and make another. I had to check on Cleo anyhow. She was only 5, and Aaron's teenage attention span to watch her wasn't a guarantee. I'm going to check on Cleo, I said, and started to stand when I saw my mother-in-law making her way across the lawn from her apartment. She held a large bowl in her hands, and I couldn't figure out why she was wearing a sweater.
Girls, Helen said. Having fun?
Joining us, Mrs. Garrett? Anna asked.
Oh, no, not me. I'm watching my shows, Helen replied.
Why are you wearing a sweater, Helen? I asked. You're going to get heat stroke.
Not me. She reached out and grabbed my arm. Phil, Mac.
Her hands were like ice.
What the heck?
I jumped a little.
You're like dead cold.
You wish. I hummed out and took a sip.
Glenn needs to fix my AC. It's too cold in my place, she said. I told him, but he's always busy with something you need him to do. I'm going to take this to the kitchen. I made macaroni salad, and I think I'll grab one of those drinks if you don't mind.
No, not at all, I told her. Can you check on Cleo, make sure she's okay? Aaron is watching her.
Aaron is great with her. Why do you worry?
She leaned down and touched my forehead.
You need to get out of the sun. You're burning up. You're the one who will get heat stroke.
Tell me about it. Maybe I'll go to your place and cool down.
You'll regret it. I'm sitting under a blanket.
As my mother-in-law slipped into the house, I looked at my friends. There was no way her place was that cold. I was about to go and find out, but when I stood, I saw Glenn's truck. He pulled into the driveway, then backed up to the fence, dripping water the whole time. It was at that second I understood why he'd purchased that ice. They were comical, moving the slippery blocks from the back end of the truck. They even dropped one. But after 20 minutes with everyone outside cheering them on, they did it. It was a stroke of brilliancy. He was putting it in the pool. I wasn't really sure how much 1,000 pounds of ice would cool down our small underground pool, but it was a great effort. The ice melted pretty quickly in the water, just like my margarita. But just like my margarita, I was going to absorb what relief from the heat I could. I was the first one in the pool, jumping in without hesitation. Maybe it was psychological, but it felt cold and so good against my burning skin. Doing something I rarely do, I joked about the floating chunks of ice and feeling like I was in the Titanic movie. No one really laughed. It wasn't that funny. But at that moment, for the first time in 31 days, I was cold. I enjoyed it because I knew, with the summer the way it was going to be a long time before I was cold again. 3. Change. July 7th. Being a deep sleeper, it took a lot to wake me up, especially if it had only been a couple hours. The night before, I'd sat in the basement family room, which was much cooler, and binge-watched on a streaming station until a little after 3. Then I went to bed, fully intent on sleeping in and not setting the alarm. Yet, there I was, feeling like the comforter had been ripped from me. But it hadn't been. I was always a cover-heavy person. I liked to be cold when I slept, snug under some heavy covers. It wasn't the case in the summer. The bed sported our hot weather bedding that was light and airy, not as heavy and snug as I preferred. The bedspread with only a top sheet worked well with the air conditioner, but not on this morning. I was so cold and shivering, I thought the covers weren't on me. When I realized they were, I groaned out, "Oh my God, turn down the air!" For sure, it had to be his supercharged AC from decades ago. I mean, that thing was a monster. I didn't get a response, and I opened my eyes. It was barely 8 in the morning, and the loud buzz and hum of the old AC wasn't ringing out. The room was quiet. I sat up. Glenn wasn't in bed. His side had the covers tossed back. I thought it was earlier than it was because it wasn't bright out. The days had been bright and sunny, but on this day, it was gloomy. Need I say it was welcome? After weeks with sun and heat, I was so happy to see it was overcast. That meant lower temperatures and possibly rain. I swore I was going to go stand in the yard the first instance of rain. It was probably too late. I could hear it hitting against the window. What a difference the beating sun must have made to the temperature of the house. I couldn't believe how cold it felt. Perhaps it was my imagination. Since I was already up, I put on my slippers, grabbed a pair of sweatpants from my drawer, and a sweater from my closet. I was sure Glenn would poke fun at me, telling me I reminded him of his mother. A nap was on the agenda for the afternoon before I'd even walked from my bedroom. I could smell the coffee the second I stepped into the hall, and I followed the aroma down to the kitchen. "Morning," I heard Glenn say from the dining room. "You're up early." "Imagine that. You aren't working today?" I asked as I grabbed a mug.
"Not today."
"Okay." I poured some coffee, added my creamer, and, cupping the mug with both hands, headed into the dining room.
I expected to see him at the table, peering at his phone, going through emails, or reading the news. Instead, my husband stood at the sliding glass doors. staring out while bringing his mug to his lips and drinking his coffee. Wondering if he saw something interesting out there, maybe his mother had another friend over, I joined him.
What are you doing?
I asked, wondering if I should put the furnace on.
I laughed. He had made a joke.
Or had he?
Glenn was drop-dead serious as he stared out.
Glenn, I know it's cooler, but...
My eyes shifted when I heard the sound of the rain against the glass. It had a thin sound to it, like a fine mist rather than raindrops.
It's cold, he said. Look at the pool.
I did. A fog hovered over our in-ground pool.
Is that steam?
Yep. Temperature fell so fast this morning, the water temperature hadn't changed, he said.
That's so strange. I mean, it isn't that cold out.
I brought my mug to my lips.
46.
The sip I took nearly choked me.
You're kidding.
Nope.
Why do you think I want to put the furnace on?
Surely it would go back up.
It could.
I say we deal with it, enjoy it, and hope the house stays cool as the temperature goes up.
I looked online, Mac, Glenn said. When I woke up and saw the temp on my phone, I thought, wow, this is unusual. And it is. The coldest day in July on record was this temperature in Alaska. We're far from Alaska.
Did you check Pennsylvania?
Yep, and it's nowhere near this.
It's early, I said. The temperature will only rise today. It has to. It's July. Have you checked the news?
No, not yet.
Morning show is on until 9. They'll cover local weather. With my coffee in hand and my sleepy state leaving, I sat on the couch, grabbed the remote, and turned on the television. I flipped the network with the perky morning ladies. I expected to see them with a guest or cooking something. I didn't expect to see a major news anchor with a map of the United States superimposed behind him.
Glenn, come look at this.
There had to be a mistake. Dramatics. I wasn't listening. The volume was down. They cut to a reporter wearing a hat and a coat. The wind was blowing and steam came from her mouth when she spoke. Were they showing a pre-recorded spot? Was the media looking to hype something that wasn't there? It was July, the hottest summer on record, yet I was looking at a weather map that made me think it was January. I felt the bounce of the couch as Glenn sat down.
Thank you, Canada, for sharing,
Glenn said quietly. Was it this cold there? I asked. Glenn shrugged.
According to that map, it's still cold there.
I looked at my husband, then back at the television just as it returned to the anchor. Glenn took the remote and raised the volume.
You would think, the newscaster said, that was Molly reporting in November, but that was live footage. No one is really certain why such a brutal cold front has descended on the northern portion of the U.S., but folks, it is here for a while. Don't make any plans to go swimming, because if you think it's cold now, it's about to get colder. A lot colder. And it looks like, the newscaster paused, it's only the beginning.
The entire day we took things in our stride, even going as far as to make jokes. The cold, damp weather, combined with a warm ground, created a dense fog. One tricky to drive or move around in. We needed to, though. It was a good day for soup, so we went to the store. I didn't know what people were thinking or if they had heard things. I thought maybe the market was having one of their super sales, the parking lot was so packed. People rushed to get inside, and Glenn had to search the lot for a cart. There was no sale, which brought me back to my original thought. People had heard a newsflash that we hadn't. The store was insane, and the lines extended way back. We were greeted immediately with the sight of half-empty shelves. Odd things like ketchup and canned tomatoes were out. It was crazy. Shoppers were treating a freak cold day like it was the day before a snow day in the winter. Panic shopping. I kept checking online. Were we missing something? Nothing indicated it was more than just a few days of freakishly cold July weather. Soup and grilled cheese sandwiches were the dinner I planned, a good winter meal in the middle of July. I baked cookies to keep the house warm, and the moisture from the soup helped. About the time the soup had simmered to perfection, I heard the triple click and whirl of the furnace. Glenn had conceded. Never would I have believed we would put on the furnace in July. Yet there we were. I caught a whiff of that burning smell that always seemed to accompany the first time the furnace was on for the season. Nothing about it felt right to me, yet the news was reporting it was just some anomaly. The only one it didn't seem to faze was Helen. I kept expecting her to tell me she remembered a time when it was this cold. She was always one to give that been-there-done-that story to quell any worries, but the stories of this happened before never came. By nightfall, the temperature hovered just above freezing and the fog was thick. So much so, Helen had to spend the night in the house with us. It was too dangerous to walk across the lawn. We couldn't even see her apartment. It seemed silly. I felt silly, breaking out the winter blankets and comforters. However, it was just too cold. Perhaps it was the weeks of exceptionally hot weather that had made us more intolerable. There was no adjustment period, like when we would go from fall to winter. Sweating one day with an air conditioning system that didn't seem to do the trick, to shivering with icy cold hands the next. This extreme. It was fast. And I was grateful it was a freak of nature and wouldn't last long. 4. Q. July 14. It was strange. All everyone talked about was the bizarre cold front that took over everything north of Kentucky the first week of July. A cold front they predicted would spread south. It was on social media, the news. People kept panic shopping, going every day. The stores assured everyone there was no shortage of food, yet there were those who were extreme. Though they weren't the norm, at least for the first couple days. Then the snow came. It never stuck. It melted right away, but it was steady and didn't stop. The blue skies were gone and every day was gray and dismal. When would it end? Then things really started to get crazy. People literally believed it was the end of the world. Level-headed people spewed irrational thoughts and fear consumed them. At work, that was all everyone talked about. When people showed up, that was. People stopped going to work everywhere. I worked for a local magistrate, and every day, more cases were canceled. Things spiraled to a doomsday mentality, and I didn't get it. Even though experts said it was just a spell, some worried it was much more, that we were being lied to and placated. My mother-in-law was one of them. In fact, she was horrible with her conspiracy theories and bickered with me. They weren't even scientific theories, they were her own mental guesses. She constantly argued with us that we needed to go south. For what? I asked. It's only going to get colder. Uncle Fred has a house in Georgia, bet it's warm there. We don't need to go to Georgia. But if you want to, I said, be my guest. Can't go to Aunt Mary's. She lives in Florida. Well, I would think Florida's even better, I said. No, before long it will be underwater. Where are you getting this from? I asked. She replied with a, you'll see. But nothing to corroborate her theory until she actually made a point one day with a paper cup. It was the day, I believe, she caught my attention. A lot changed that day. She made her way across the lawn, carrying this saran-covered plastic solo cup. She wore her favorite beige raincoat and a plastic red polka-dot rain bonnet. She had a couple of those bonnets, courtesy of my son, Aaron. They were his go-to Christmas and birthday gifts, since she proclaimed to love them so much. I kind of think she did. She wore them all the time. Aaron always found her amusing and fed into her eccentricities and quirkiness.
Mr. Richter, Helen said smugly.
Who is Mr. Richter? I asked,
My fourth grade science teacher.
My God, what a memory, I said. That was ages ago.
Ma, Aaron said, Graham is smart.
Thank you, honey, Helen said. You're the best.
So are you, Graham. Christ, I mumbled, and returned my attention to the small kitchen television.
Oh, am I bothering you? Helen asked. You asked me a question 2 days ago, and I'm here to answer it. I just had to have proof.
Okay, I faced her. I'm all ears. What was the question?
You asked where I was getting my information when I said everything was going to flood.
Okay, I nodded.
Mr. Richter, she said.
Your fourth grade science teacher. Don't tell me he's still alive.
Go on with that sass, she said. I remember him telling me that it takes 3 inches of rain to equal 1 inch of snow. I remember a big snowstorm 1 year, and he said we were lucky it was snow or we'd give Noah a run for his flood money.
I highly doubt that, I said, but go on. She placed the cup on the counter and lifted the plastic wrap. I peered in. It's water.
Yes, it is, she replied.
Actually, it's snow. Snow melts. It's been snowing steadily for an entire day. 24 hours and the snow just falls and melts. This was placed outside this morning. There is 5 inches of water in here. It's an inch an hour.
Holy shit, Aaron blurted.
Aaron, I scolded on his language.
No, that's smart, Graham. Helen nodded. There's no evaporation because it keeps coming. An inch an hour. She gave a twitch of her head. Take a look at your pool.
With the slow sidestep, I moved by Helen and my son toward the patio doors. I looked out and released a slight gasp. The water in my pool was nearly to the edge.
Any higher, Helen said, I may have to break out the galoshes.
I just kept staring.
2 more days, Helen added. It's gonna flood the drainage system, the rivers, creeks. If it keeps going like this, we'll need to go south. I'm not saying to higher ground, but maybe.
That just seemed so extreme. I was in a daze, staring at the water, the large falling snowflakes that disappeared as soon as they hit the pool. I was starstruck by the weather, so much so that when Glenn's truck whizzed into the driveway splashing the water, I jumped. Why was he driving so fast?
Is that Dad? Aaron asked.
Yeah, I replied. I watched Glenn step out of the truck as he carried one can of his grocery store bag. He walked around toward the front of the house, avoiding the backyard, and I went back to the kitchen.
He's been gone a while, Aaron said.
I know. I heard the front door open and then Cleo calling out excitedly for her father. With our 5-year-old on his hip, Glenn entered the kitchen and placed the bag on the counter. You were gone a really long time, I said.
Yeah, it sucks, Glenn replied.
Glenn, I looked in the bag. Is this it? Did you forget the list?
No.
That, Glenn set down Cleo and whispered to her,
go watch TV, honey.
He looked at me and reached into the bag.
This is all we're allowed.
What? I asked in shock. What do you mean?
We're not permitted to shop. I guess to stop the hoarders, I don't know.
There was nothing on the news, Glenn shrugged.
I don't know what to tell you. It's the way it is. I had to wait in line for a pre-packaged bag of groceries. 3 days, family of four.
5, Helen corrected.
Sorry, Mom, Glenn said. You and Cleo count as half a person each.
Wait, stop. I waved out my hand. They told you what you can get?
More like they just handed us what we could have.
But that makes no sense, I said. Did they say why?
No one gave me answers, Mac. It's just the way it is.
I can't accept that, I argued. I can't.
I don't know what to tell you, Glenn replied.
I don't. Maybe if you try another store. You probably misunderstood or went to the wrong place. Did you try Big Bear?
Mac, he said, my name with a snap to it. It's that way everywhere, okay? I don't know what you want me to tell you. It is the way it is. Why do you think this is on me?
I just would have tried elsewhere, I said. One of the smaller markets, maybe the big ones are just falling into line. Falling into line of what? Glenn asked. This isn't a conspiracy theory. This is a national emergency. They have to control things. So we're just supposed to accept it, I asked. What choice do we have? Glenn responded. The stores are basically shut down. They give you a bag of nothing, but you can't touch the shelves? No, Glenn said. From what I saw, the shelves were bare. It was weird. And it wasn't even the workers. It was like government people, Glenn said.
They can't do that, I argued.
They can, Helen stated. They will, and they did.
Oh, please.
My eyes rolled slightly as I looked at her, facially showing how ridiculous I thought her response was.
Over the top, just like Helen.
Where's all the food? Aaron asked. I mean, there are warehouses. Why didn't they restock the shelves?
I'll tell you why, Helen interjected. The government seized all the food. Probably doing some sort of major foraging and moving the items south. Have to have items down there for all the people.
I huffed a little in disbelief, shaking my head. She's right, Glenn said. The government has taken control of food and warehouses the ship south. Mac, he said my name softly. There's a major evacuation in effect. I mean, turn on the news. Is it flooding? Aaron asked. I don't know, Glenn replied. It definitely is weather-related. Our city? I questioned. We have all those rivers and the entire north. Glenn cut me off. North what? America, Glenn said. Everyone must move below the southernmost part of the Mason-Dixon line. It's like you take a line and draw it straight through Arkansas across the country. His words made me nearly stumble in shock. How are they going to evacuate the entire northern half? More than half? Glenn shook his head. Don't know. They said there is a schedule in order to prevent a mass exodus. Every area will be given an evacuation time and location. You're supposed to put in your address and it tells you where to go and your evacuation date.
State for state, Helen said. City for city. Move us to a comparable area, probably set up camps.
We don't know, I said. They're not even saying why. Isn't it obvious, Mom? Aaron asked. It's July. It's 34 degrees. My son didn't need to say it. No one did. I knew the answer to that one. Only one thing coming would cause all of us to head south. Unimaginable, not survivable. Cold.
It was all over the news that a government website would launch at 8 that evening. I knew it was going to be a disaster. Everyone going online at the same time. Half the country needed to know where they had to go and when. Of course, unsurprisingly, we were unable to log on. System overload. Yet, according to social media, people were in and finding out the plan. Obviously, the site worked in some place. While I waited, I researched. It was hard to believe something that big causing an evacuation was actually happening. Every news site, every web page was all doom and gloom. I couldn't even go down my social media feed without seeing something about it.
It was being called the Big Cold.
Similar to the last mini ice age, scientists were attributing it to something called a grand solar minimum. I wasn't exactly sure what that was, but it had to do with the sun's activity. It caused the last one. We were expected to face the same, only colder. The government was stating it was a precaution.
Some said it was never going to happen, while some experts said it would be worse than we could imagine.
Those opinions I dismissed. I didn't want to hear them. I wanted to know if we had to leave. How long was it going to last? I found social media groups that were claiming they were writing it out and stating where. The search for answers felt like one of those times I was hungry and couldn't find anything to satisfy that hunger, even with a full fridge. Lots of information was out there, but
but nothing I wanted to hear and nothing that really told me much. Admittedly, I sought out opinions that called the big code ludicrous, that it was all hype, some sort of political thing, the government's way of controlling people.
But why would they move everybody if it was?
We weren't the only country doing it either. This thing was global. It was quickly put together, too fast, as if they'd known it was coming for some time. They were moving entire neighborhoods to a single location.
I read online a prison in Texas was holding 1,412 residents from an Ohio town. Prisons, makeshift camps, arenas, schools, everything was being used.
My next-door neighbor got online. She told me once you put in your address, your evacuation location appeared along with your leave date. Then, after that, you filled in details and registered. She left a few things out. Maybe she didn't want to give me too much information in case I was never able to get in. I worried for a bit. What if we never found out our location? Then, just before 4 a.m, I was able to log in.
I waited in a queue for nearly an hour after I put in our address.
I was nervous. Then it popped up. RCGA 223. Relocation Camp 223. Bainbridge, Georgia. The note said, under construction. I didn't know what that entailed, but I was glad it wasn't a prison. After I registered the family and names, the rules were displayed. A copy, they politely stated, would be emailed to me, just like an airplane, no more than one bag and one personal item per person, and it gave the measurements. Food was permitted to be brought into camp in a duffel bag no longer than 36 inches. We also were allowed to bring one aluminum briefcase with personal documents and items. The case had to be purchased.
If anything over the allotment was brought to camp, we would be asked to leave it behind. How in the world does one fit their entire life into a backpack and small suitcase?
We had to up and leave our homes and life to go to some strange place, with no say whatsoever where we went. The strict rules and relocation policies were to avoid chaos and mass hysteria. I wanted to cry. Then I saw our evacuation date. September 14th. That was 2 months away. I breathed out in relief. Whatever was happening, this big cold wasn't as severe as they were saying. It couldn't be. Not if they were giving us a 2-month heads up. And a lot could happen in 2 months. I was siding with the naysayers and putting my faith in the hope that the big cold was going to be one of those media hypes like Y2K or 2012, and come September, we wouldn't be leaving. We'd be laughing about it. 5. Red Rubber Boots. August 1st. Packing up our things wasn't even a thought or option, nor would it have been for a while had the weather not taken such a drastic turn. Odd storms would move in at night, bringing severe winds, lightning, and falling temperatures. It was impossible to leave at night. Everything froze over, and when it started to defrost during the day, the falling snow just turned everything on the ground into slush. Until it froze over again. A daily occurrence of rinse and repeat weather. Helen was the only one thinking ahead, scraping a thing or two from our 3-day rations, going through what she had in her own cupboards to see what she could compact into her personal bag. Truth was, the amount of food given wasn't enough, and any extra we had in our pantries was dwindling, especially when they switched the ration days to once a week and did so without notice. Everything changed fast. We went from being free to being regimented. Only essential services worked, which left my job as a magistrate clerk obsolete.
Suddenly, my view of the world changed.
I went from being out there daily to stuck in my house, fighting every urge I had not to become one of those millions who were freaking out. The circumstances they threw at us didn't help. Rolling blackouts occurred during the day to conserve power. We were given a day and time to collect our rations. If we missed it, we didn't get anything for a week. Fuel purchase was regulated to the bare minimum in an attempt to keep people from joining the already congested roads for the exodus. When it was your time to go, you would be given enough fuel. No one worked, and no one had money. A way to control everything. It wasn't that way everywhere, just in places that were to be evacuated. While we were in a police state, everywhere else lived normally. They weren't happy about the exodus or sharing their areas. There were social media groups complaining, petitions being signed. I feared for my family when we did go. Helen kept insisting we go to her brother's. As crazy as he was, it was better. Plus, he was in Georgia, so we would be on our designated route. My kids were tougher than I was. Cleo took everything in her stride and spent the days doing things a 5-year-old would do. Not paying attention or caring about what was going on. Aaron didn't want to know. He hid that he was a little sad when they canceled school. I guess at 17 that had more to do with not seeing his friends. I was constantly online looking for answers. I wasn't even sure of the questions in my mind. I just needed information. It couldn't be happening. It didn't make any sense. Glenn worked, though. He took a job doing contract work for the government building check-in stations on the highway. It didn't pay cash. It paid commodities, such as fuel. And once the project was done, he earned extra food bags. He wouldn't have taken it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.